Welcome to our coverage of financial statement analysis. You'll want to note that the initial coverage of this chapter is based on the example called Aggie Inc. You'll want to look for that in your lecture notes and use it as a reference as we go along. Now, to look at those financial statements, you'll see that you're given a comparative balance sheet with assets, liabilities, and equities for 20X1 and 20X2. 20X1 being the earliest year. You also see comparative income statements for 20X1 and 20X2, and then some additional information that we will look at as we need that information, but so we'll reference that as we go along. So what is this financial statement analysis? And all it is a set of tools that we use to make the general purpose financial statements that you learned about in your first accounting course. What we try to do is make them more useful to different users, and management will try to assess different aspects of the business using these tools called financial statement analysis. There's going to be three basic tools that we talk about in this course. One is horizontal analysis, one is vertical analysis, and one is ratio analysis. Anytime you calculate the vertical, the horizontal, the ratio analysis, it is important to note that really for it to be meaningful, you need to make comparisons with something. So that something, that standard, could be the past history of the company. We'll calculate something called the current ratio. And maybe last year it was 2.5 and this year it's 2.0. We could make a comparison and make conclusions based on that. We could try to compare to a similar company if we can find one. So, for example, if you're PepsiCo, you could compare to Coca-Cola. But that's actually a little bit harder than it sounds, because oftentimes, while they sound like very similar companies, differences in accounting methods, differences in what the business really is, causes this to be very difficult. So you can use industrial averages. Examples of that would be Moody's or Standard & Poor's or Dun & Bradstreet, which you can easily find online or the Wall Street Journal. All right, horizontal analysis. This is sometimes called trend analysis. And what you try to do is focus on the change, whether it's the dollar change or the percentage change in the accounts on the income statement and the balance sheet from year to year. So you're just trying to focus on the change, and we can identify trends. It lets us answer questions like, what percentage did cash increase last year? All right, let's take a look at Aggie's financial statements. Before we do, I should say that there really are two ways of looking at this horizontal analysis. The first way is to show this as a percentage of the base year. You'll take the current year amount divided by the base year amount. So write this formula down, and we'll look at it in just a minute. Current year amount divided by base year amount. The other way is you can take the dollar change in that account and divide by the base year amount. Now, these formulas don't make a lot of sense just looking at them, but it is important to note that the base year is typically the first year given, the earliest year shown. Now let's look at Aggie. I've prepared the horizontal analysis for you in your lecture notes just to keep you from having to make all these calculations. So let's focus on cash. Cash in 20X1 was $5,000, in 20X2 it was $6,000, so there was a $1,000 increase. This translates to a 20% increase. Now this can be looked at as increase of $1,000 divided by the base year, the earliest year shown, which is 20X1, or 5,000. So 1,000 divided by 5,000 is 20%. So we know that cash increased by 20% from 20X1 to 20X2. Now the other way we could look at this is to take the amount for 20X2 of $6,000 and divide by the base year amount, you'll get 120%. So they really give you the same answer. One tells you cash increased 20%. The other calculation tells you that cash is 120% of what it was in 19x1. So they both indicate a 20% increase. Now if we turn our focus to the liabilities, we could calculate that in one of two ways as well. We could say that accounts payable increased $6,000 over the base year amount of $7,000. It increased 85.71%. Alternatively, $13,000 for 20x2 divided by $7,000 for 20x1 says that accounts payable is 185.71% of what it was last year. So again, they both indicate about an 86% increase in our accounts payable. So horizontal analysis looks at changes in accounts over time. If you had multiple years, you see how you could identify whether cash was on an upward trend or a downward trend. Now, if we do this for the income statement, it works the same way. We can see from Aggie Inc. that sales increased $6,000. So $6,000 divided by $89,000 is a 6.74% increase. So sales increased about 7%. Now, if we look at cost of goods sold, we can see that increased zero. Zero divided by the base year amount of $43,000, that's the 20x1 amount, that's a 0% increase. Now I show you this one because you can see if you really want to do an in-depth analysis, you could look at this and say sales increased 7%, but the cost of the inventory sold increased zero. And you could draw conclusions about that, like perhaps they controlled inventory costs better or charged a higher price. You could look at this and draw some conclusions. Vertical analysis, on the other hand, is going to look at a single financial statement for a single year. It's going to look vertically within the same statement. You can make comparisons. Even though you're going to make your calculations based on the numbers in a single year, you can then compare that to the prior year. So don't be fooled by the name vertical analysis. There's still going to be comparisons. What you'll do is express each item within a financial statement as a percentage of some selected item on the statement. And there are specific items that you need to use to calculate this. For the balance sheet, you'll express everything as a percentage of total assets. You'll take the account balance for every account in the balance sheet and divide by total assets. Now, if you look in your notes, you'll see that I did prepare this vertical analysis for you, and I did this for both 20x2 and 20x1. So just looking at this, you could see that to calculate cash, the 6.45%, you would take the cash account balance of $6,000 and divide by total assets of $93,000. That tells you that cash was 6.45% of total assets. Now you could look at the prior year and see that cash was 5.81% of total assets. And you could look for significant changes between the 2 years if you want to identify what's going on. Looking specifically at inventory, 20x2 inventory was $23,000. Total assets were $93,000, so inventory was almost 25% of total assets. We could do the same thing if we want to look at accounts payable. Accounts payable balance is $13,000, and if we divide by total assets of $93,000, we'll see that accounts payable is 13.98% of total assets. Now, obviously, you could look at this as 93,000 as the total liabilities and stockholders' equity. Because really what, for example, accounts payable is saying is that about 14% of assets are funded or paid for with accounts payable. Or you could look at it as accounts payable makes up 14% of liabilities and equities. So it's easiest to remember, divide all balance sheet items by total assets. But you can interpret it either way. All right, so again, inventory calculation, that 23,000 of inventory balance divided by 93,000 of total assets, that 24.73%, what that means is that inventory makes up 24.73% of assets during 20X2. Now we can turn our focus to the income statement, and in the income statement, everything is expressed as a percentage of net sales. So you'll take the account balance for every income statement item and divide by net sales. So looking at Aggie Inc., I have prepared this vertical analysis for you. Sales is 100% of sales in 20X2. Cost of goods sold is 43,000 divided by 95,000, or 45.26%. We could jump down and look at wages. Wages were 27,000. So we'll take 27,000 divided by 95,000, and we'll see that wages were 28.42% of sales. So about 28% of sales went toward paying for wages. It's interesting to note that wages were only 23.6% of sales in the prior year. So again, you can make comparisons to a prior year, even though your calculation is made within a given year. All right, so again, interpretation on that wages expense, $27,000 of wages over $95,000 of sales, you get 28.42%. And this means that 28.42% of sales went toward covering wages expense during the year. The last tool is called ratio analysis, and this will take a bit longer to discuss, so we're going to have separate presentations for that. But what we're trying to do with our ratio analysis is try to look at mathematical relationships between two or more variables within your financial statements. And we're going to look at how ratios can be used by managers specifically. We'll look at how managers can assess liquidity, profitability, debt management, asset management, and market performance. Now, a couple things to note. When you make calculations for ratio analysis, sometimes the formula will call for the average balance. You will take the beginning balance plus the ending balance and divide by two. That's the average over the year. But note that when you're given 2 years of financial statements, the beginning balance is the prior year's financial statement balance, because what you ended 1 year with on the balance sheet, you will begin the next year with. Your ending balance, of course, will come from the current year's financial statements. All right, that's why you're going to be given comparative financial statements. Now, one other thing that you will want to make a note of, the ratio formulas. So all of those liquidity, profitability, asset management, debt management, market performance, all those ratios, the formulas will be provided on the exam. I will label them and tell you what formula it is, and I will give you the formula. So you don't have to memorize them. Now, this does not include the formulas for horizontal and vertical analysis. You're going to need to know those. This does not include the formulas for any other chapter. It is just the ones marked ratio analysis. So make yourself a note in your lecture notes These formulas will be provided on the exam. All right, so next in the future presentations, we will discuss the ratio analysis. I know that you'll want to get excited about that, or at least get motivated to do it. So listen to the next presentation when you're ready. Bring questions to class. See you then.